Your grace and mercy brought me through. I'm living this moment because of you.
Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. We've come to lift up his holy name on this last Sunday of Black History Month. I wonder if anybody can just say, thank you, Lord. I wonder if somebody can say, Lord, we glorify you. Lord, we honor you. God, we thank you for who you are. Come on, put those blessed hands together and give the Lord some praise with the fruit of your lips. As we're standing, we want to lift the 100th Psalm. David says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving. And into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. If you believe it, put those blessed hands together. Hallelujah. If you're just joining us, we want to welcome you to this worship experience virtually as we come from near and far. Here at the Ebenezer Baptist Church, where we're moving faith forward, let's collectively just begin to cry out to the Lord. Come on, somebody cry out. Somebody say hallelujah. Come on, somebody say thank you, Jesus. Somebody say you're worthy, Lord. You're worthy, Lord. You're worthy. Hallelujah. Come on, make it personal. Make it personal. Make your worship personal between you and God. Lord, we love you. God, we magnify you. Lord, we adore you for who you are. We invite you into this space. And we say, have your way. Have your way, oh God. We're not worthy, but you are worthy of all glory. You're worthy of all honor. You're worthy of all praise, God. And we say, thank you. God, we say, have your way in this worship experience. Touch us from the oldest to the youngest, to the one that's been here the longest, to the newest of us that are just joining. Let us experience your Shekinah glory in this place. Have your way, we pray. We will be careful to give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. We say together, amen, hallelujah. Listen, we are the Ebenezer Baptist Church and we are moving faith forward. Come on, let's read our mission statement together. Simply says we are moving forward by empowering people to spiritual maturity, by encouraging healthy environments where they can take their next steps in knowing, growing, and showing their love of God. This is the time. This is the place that God has called us to give him glory, to give him honor, and to give him praise. So it's with an attitude of gratitude that we're in worship on one accord. Listen, when we have a presentation of Black excellence as we celebrate Trailblazers, I want you to enjoy this presentation that has been put together as we not revel in our own accomplishments as much as we say thank you, Lord, for every good and perfect gift comes from him. Won't you be blessed?
Where is she? on back peaceful.
Whoa. Easy now.
I'm gonna be free or die.
I've been walking with my face turned to the sun. Weight on my shoulders, a bullet in my gun. Oh, I got eyes in the back of my head, just in case I have to run. I can for my people. While the clouds roll back and the stars fill the night, that's when I'm gonna stand up, take my people with me. Together we are going to a brand new home, far across the river. Can you hear freedom? Can feel it in my bones.
You have made it 100 miles to freedom. Would you like to pick a new name to mark your freedom?
Paratum.
Early in the morning, before the sun begins to shine, we're gonna start moving. Was that separating line? I'm wading through muddy waters. You know I got a made up mind. And I don't mind if I lose any blood on the way to salvation. And I'll fight with the strength that I got until I die. So I'm gonna stand up, take my people with me. Together we are going to a brand new home, far across the river. Can you hear freedom calling, calling me to answer? Gonna keep on keeping on.
Harriet, welcome to the Underground Railroad.
Together we are going to a brand new
pray that you were encouraged. Hallelujah. All month long, the Lord has blessed us. We thank God for Brother Moderator Henderson. We thank God for the leadership of the Children and Youth Ministry. For we were blessed on this past Sunday, 3 p.m., all of our young people did a marvelous job. And I was mighty glad to hear my son bring a word of encouragement to his generation. No greater gift than for us to give ourselves away to this present generation. And so I want to challenge you today to give of your time. Give of your talents. Give of your tithes. For the Lord promises, pressed down, shaken together, running over will he put into your lap. Hallelujah. For the measure that you give will be the measure you give back. It's offering time. It is giving time. We want to encourage you to give. Give not out of compulsion, but out of a sense of gratitude for all that the Lord has done for you. You can give to Givelify. You can give to 909 Queen Street, Alexandria, Virginia, 22314. We want to encourage you to be a blessing to the forceful advancement of Jesus Christ in the earth. Man, woman, boy, or girl, allow the Lord to use you in this season. Amen? Hallelujah. Listen, family, I want you to prepare your hearts and your minds to receive a word that I know is ordained by God. Open up your hearts, open up your spiritual ears to hear, your spiritual eyes, so that you may see what the Lord has to say to us on today. When you receive our psalmist as you come. Amen. Hallelujah.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark path has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought.
Voices, and ultimately we believe that God was pleased. I want to draw your attention to a familiar passage of scripture found in Romans. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Romans 12. Hallelujah. In those first two verses, King James Version, last Sunday, Black History Month, I can hear our ancestors sing, that old Negro spiritual. And before I be a slave, I'll be buried in my grave and go home to be with my Lord and be free. I can see their struggle. I can see the sacrifice. And on today, the Lord is requiring nothing less than our total commitment to Him. Won't you read with me Romans 12, verses 1 through 2, King James Version says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present, here it is, your bodies, my Lord, a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed. Somebody just type, transform me, Lord. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. For a moment, I want to preach from the thought, be a trailblazer. Hallelujah. Be a trailblazer. Hallelujah. Kind Father, in the name of Jesus, hottest preacher behind the cross, speak on my feeble words. Help the receiver to hear what the Holy Spirit has to say to the church. Lord, we thank you. We glorify you. We honor you. And we lift you up. Say, have your way, oh God. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. The body of believers said together, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Be a trailblazer, family. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Listen, all month long, family, we have been celebrating Black History Month. All month, we've celebrated Harriet Tubman. Come on, we celebrated Frederick Douglass. We celebrated Kamala, Vice President Harris. We celebrated on Tuesdays for Bible study. We talked about Brother Booker T in a barbershop. Last Sunday, my cousin inspired me during the preach moment, Dr. Tyrone Glover. We talked about it. We talked about even that young poet who stood at the inauguration, one of only three others, I believe, that had been used to at the swearing in of a president. And we heard young Amanda Gorman lift her voice. And we've been compelled. We saw the presentation of Black excellence, of excelling those who were the first in their fields to do great things. And it was to advance our nation, it was to advance the world, and ultimately, it's to advance what God is doing in the life of every believer. And so today, I hear the Spirit of God saying, be a trailblazer. Hallelujah. Can somebody just type, I'm going to be a trailblazer. I'm going to be a trailblazer. And I want to let you know, at the onset of this conversation and looking at this particular pericopean text, let me say, at the onset of this, being a trailblazer will get you misunderstood. becoming a trailblazer. People may turn you off. Being a trailblazer, mumbling and grumbling may come as a part of you being a trailblazer. Some may even look at you and say that you are anti-cultural or counter-cultural to what we're used to doing. Being a trailblazer means that you walk out uncharted territory as you are guided and led by the power of the Holy Spirit. I want to let you know that don't think it's strange when people look at you strange because you are a trailblazer. I'm here to let you know that there's a place for you, my friend. There's a place that God has prepared for those who are willing to take God at his word and become living, breathing, epistle trailblazers for him. In this familiar text, I bore you, the Apostle Paul, having now finished the doctrinal part. So chapters 1 through 11 is the doctrinal part of his message, okay? But what precedes now is the practical. Hallelujah. And so this is something that each and every one of us, no matter where we are in our sojourn with the Lord, can apply to our lives. Listen again. He says, these two verses, a 1-2 punch, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies, here it is, a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. I love the King James Version. I love it. Verse 2, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove that which is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. The believer, hear me clearly, it is called to commit to God. This message, it is really a call to dedication to God. It's a call to commitment. Everything that the believer has and is and does ought to be out of a committed or devoted sense of God, an extension of God, because you're dedicated your life and your service and your worship to God. Anything less, hallelujah, is a sin before God. Your speech, hallelujah, your motives, your actions, anything other than a full-on commitment does not bring glory and honor to God. I got to draw the line in the sand today. Listen, the believer, above all, is called to this kind of unwavering commitment. Somebody say, why, Dr. Jackson? I'm glad you asked. Because there's too much on the line. Too many souls hang in the balance. If our footing is not sure, if our stance is not full and complete, if we, hallelujah, are wavering to and fro, running after this doctrine and that one, if we, hallelujah, have no sense of commitment and we just blow with the wind in every different direction, we're no different than the world, and the world is looking from something different than itself, and God has called us to be that difference. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Everything, when we're discussing, I just want to get this out of the way. Everything that we're discussing that the believer's relationship to God. Scripture is real strong in here. Scripture is strong in its exhortation of this. Without equivocation, Scripture urges total devotion to God. And so unwavering in our commitment to God is what God is calling us for. And so this first verse, it is a devotion that is urged. In this first verse, that there's an urge and a pleading, and I'll get there in a moment, a pleading that we present our bodies as a living sacrifice. But not only that, in verse 2, there's this call to not be conformed to this world. And then finally, there's a call to be transformed. It's no secret that the world is desperately in need of a savior. The world desperately needs God. And the only way for the world to get right with God is clearly revealed through his son, Jesus Christ. We know that Jesus came, he died, he lived, but he died in order to set man free. He becomes the justification for access to God. He becomes the propitiation, that $10 word. He becomes the ransom. He becomes the good payment, if it were, in order for us, in order to receive mercy and grace and find favor with God. I don't want to drag that out, but I want to let you know that God, through Jesus Christ, has called us to be sanctified, that is to be set apart. And so notice, if you will, that this letter is not addressed, in these first two verses, it's not addressed to the unbeliever. These first two verses, hallelujah, it is talking to those who've already confessed Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And so very much so, I'm pushing the believer. This is some housekeeping, hallelujah. This is some housekeeping and preparation, here it is, for what has to take place, for what's going to take place down the road. Here it is, the believer or the church is now God's choice, get this, to carry the gospel of his son Jesus Christ throughout the whole world. And so when you, believer, receive the word, when you, believer, receive the revelation, you take it and you share it with those who are in darkness so that they may see your good works and glorify the Father which is in heaven. I'm going to get to where I'm going in a minute. This is the glorious message of how much God loves us and what God is willing to do. He'll stop at nothing to let us know how much he loves us. So when the writer, the Apostle Paul, says, the mercies of God, I beseech you by the mercies of God, what is meant are the mercies of God. It is that God is overwhelming with blessings, overflowing with mercy, things that we don't earn, can't deserve, and still God gives it to us. Just think about it, what God has done for you. Come on, you can preach this part right through here. I don't know what the Lord has done for you, but you know. You know when you should have been, you should have gone snap, crackle, and pop. You know when you could have lost your mind. You know when you could have lost your life. You know when things could have been turned another way, and yet it's turning around for your good. I'm taking my time because every now and then we got to be reminded of the mercies of God, and they are plentiful. The mercies of God are bounteous. Come on, they know no bounds. They are limitless for what he pours out to us. And so And so God meets our desperate needs. He meets us at our places of brokenness. He meets us when we are in distress, and he provides us with mercy in our time of need. Paul is trying to appeal, hallelujah, to your senses. He's trying to appeal to your memory banks of where the Lord has brought you from. We must dedicate, here it is, and commit ourselves fully to him. Hallelujah. So Paul says, I beseech you, meaning I implore you. He says, I'm begging you to devote yourselves to God. Hallelujah. No, this point, what is about to be said, it is not being said to the world. Hallelujah. What was saying, what's being said, it is said to arrest the believer. Hallelujah. It says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, there's kindredness there. The devotion to God is strongly urged. And I want to let you know 2 points, and I promise to bid you farewell. If you're going to be a trailblazer for God, we see it in the text here, 2 points. The first point is that you've got to be willing to commit your body to God. Somebody say, commit your body. Commit your body. Hallelujah. I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you. The importance of the human body can never be overstated. Your body matters to God. And I dare say he can grab your spirit. Hallelujah. We are spirit beings. Come on. When the spirit of the Lord it is in the house, every other spirit is subject to that spirit. And so that's the easy part. But I want to appeal to that fleshly part. I want to appeal to your sin condition, the good that I would do, I don't do, but evil is all around. I want to appeal to the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. God wants your body. Come on, can you turn and tell somebody who's in the room with you, God wants your body. He wants your body. He can take your soul. He has ownership of it, but he's given us free will over our bodies. That's why Paul is saying, give your body away to God. Give it away as, here it is, a living sacrifice. Yes, Lord, I feel your spirit. I feel your spirit. Hallelujah. Come on, you got to shake yourself. Hallelujah. You got to wake yourself. Young people say, you got to stay woke right now. You got to shake your fleshly desires. Hallelujah. Because many of us have seen it and even done it to ourselves. We have been guilty of abuse of God's temple. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. A man abuses, man and woman neglects and ignores the body. Hallelujah, hallelujah. If I had time, I tell you, some say it's fear of success and fear of failure that causes us to abuse the body. It's fear of success that we get a membership to a gym. It's fear of failure that we don't show up and we're still paying money for something that we're not using. Come on, how many diets are you gonna go on? Hallelujah. How many outfits, jogging uniforms and clothes are you gonna buy? How many more pairs of sneakers do you need and you know you're not going to use it? God says, I need your body. We've witnessed it. We've been there. We've seen it. We've perhaps participated and been guilty. Help me, Holy Ghost, of overeating, of overindulging, of becoming inactive couch potatoes. Come on, somebody say, I just got COVID weight. Holly, the devil is a liar. Come on, even you got to run up and down the steps. Preach, Pastor Jackson. Preach, doctor. Listen, even if you got to do it all by yourself, come on, God said, I want your body. I want your body. We've been too long acting a fool. Hallelujah. We've been too long not bringing our bodies under subjection of God. Come on, some of us have been cursers. Some of us have been fighters. Some have been killers by partaking of harmful substances, by caring for the external, abusing the internal, by getting too much, my Lord, or too little rest. That's abuse. That's neglect. Come on, that's ignoring what God has given us. And if I had time, I could do a workshop. Come on, we could do a 10-week course on neglecting the body and the side effects of neglecting the body. What happens when you don't care for the body? What takes place when you're malnutrition? What takes place when you're sleep deprived? What takes place when you're constantly pumping substances into your body? Hallelujah. This can go on and on and on, but just to mention it, these are just a few clear sins that strikes at the point. God is saying, I want you to commit your body. If there's ever an exhortation of scripture, these two verses meet that. The believer is to present his or her body as a living sacrifice to God. There's at least three facts. God demands the believer's body. He demands it. Can I take my time? God wants the body to be a living sacrifice for him. Now we were in Sunday school. I remember that Sarah, hallelujah, and Abraham wanted a son for so long. The Lord finally blessed them with young Isaac, and Abraham is about to sacrifice his only son that God ordained, that blessed his union with his wife with. And the Lord saw his faithfulness and said, there's a ram in the thicket. Because of your faithfulness, you don't have to sacrifice your son. So the sacrifice that we're speaking of is not, hallelujah, a burnt offering sacrifice, but it's a living sacrifice. And living means that it's constant. It's constant. It's just like the air we breathe, that we inhale and exhale, is constant. The constant fluidity of our commitment, the constant giving of ourselves away to God is constant. It is a continuous sacrifice. It's not one of those things where we can give ourselves away on Sunday, but here come Monday, we're not going to give ourselves away. Here come Tuesday, we'll think about it, but we're not going to do it all the way through Saturday, and then Sunday come back and we say, I give myself away. No. That's not the kind of sacrifice that God is saying that he desires. But it is a daily walk. It's a daily study. It's a daily striving. A living sacrifice. It is giving of a person's body, whatever the body is. The sacrifice is living. The sacrifice, it hurts. The sacrifice, it is denying. The sacrifice, the living sacrifice, is the body that sacrifices its own desires and lives for God. What if everybody threw up their hands and said, you know what? I don't feel like it anymore. I'm just going to do my own thing. Come on. God is saying we're beyond the milk. But now we need to savor on the meaty spiritual things of God. And God blesses those who are living sacrifices unto him. No matter where the believer's body is, whether you're at home, whether you're at church, whether you're in the school, whether you're in the office, whether you're in a plant, in the field, whether you're in a restaurant, whether you're at a club, whether you're on a plane, in a car, or a train, listen, on a boat, God requires that you be a living sacrifice and commit your body. That's what it takes to be a trailblazer. It takes discipline. It takes focus. It takes readiness with hand to the plow and not looking back and being unwavering and a total commitment, total dedication of all that you have, all that you are to God. Commit your body. But finally, number two, you got to commit your mind. Somebody just type, commit your mind and be not conformed to this world, but be what? Transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Your mind cannot be committed if it is not first transformed. Hallelujah. We'll be putting the cart before the horse if we were looking for a commitment without transformation. Listen, where your mind is, your body is going to follow. Hallelujah. That's why we got to get rid of stinking thinking. Hallelujah. My daddy used to say, as a little boy growing up, he said, it's better to be thought of as a fool than for you to open up your mouth and then to remove all doubt. I finally grabbed what he was saying. Hallelujah. You can always tell what somebody is when they open up their mouth. You can always tell what they're thinking by what comes out of their mouths. Hallelujah. And so the body follows where the mind is, practically speaking. Let me make it a little plainer. You give him your mind. The world, here it is, wants control of your mind. But God wants to transform your mind. And so when you give God your mind, he's able to transform your thoughts to his thoughts. He's able to let you see another, broader, bigger perspective. And instead of you being so self-centered, so in the moment, you recognize that you are simply running your leg of the relay race called life. You're simply being a word bearer. You're simply giving it all that you have in order for someone behind you, hallelujah, or before you, that you're going to pass the baton to, so that somebody else can run with the vision. Somebody else can run with the word of God. And all of God's children can be blessed together. And this word, I want to take a moment or two to share this. The word transform is the same that's found, and look this up, in Matthew 17 and 2. It's transfigure. It's come from the English language as the word metamorphosis. Hallelujah. It describes, get this, a change from within. Lord have mercy. The world wants to change your mind, so it exerts pressure from within. Hallelujah. It exerts pressure from without. And so it's like this bottle. And the world is trying to squeeze and squeeze and squeeze. And all the pressures of life are trying to unsettle what's going on in the inside of you. But the Holy Spirit changes your mind by releasing power from within. He pours out. He pours out his spirit. He pours out his joy. He pours out his love. He pours out his peace that passes all understanding. And that comes from within. If the world controls your thinking, you are a conformer. You are a follower. You just go ahead and get in line and do what everybody else is doing. You become the world. You stop thinking for yourself. You stop questioning. You stop rationalizing, and you simply become robotic and even mechanic in your responses. But if God, somebody said, but if God controls your thinking, you then are a transformer. Somebody type, God, transform me. Transform me. I want to be transformed. God transforms, here it is, our minds. He makes, hallelujah, he makes our minds spiritually focused and stayed on him. And our spiritual mindedness gives us awareness of the word of God. Okay, and so when we're spiritually minded, although we may have never come to this kind of intersection, to this kind of obstacle in our lifetime, we've got a cheat sheet called the Word of God that is the blueprint, the playbook for how we ought to execute. And based on the Word, based on the mind of God, we're able to navigate. David says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will what? Fear no evil. In his humanness, he could never do that. But because he's plugged in, because he knows the word, because he has a relationship, because his mind is being transformed from the inside out, he said, I will fear no evil. Why? Because thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. He says, thou prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemies. And then he ends with a shout. He ends with a praise. He says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I dwell in the house of the Lord forever. When you've got blessed assurance, when you've got transformation, a metamorphosis is taking place with your mind, you can command your body to be still. You can command your limbs to give God praise. You can command your mouth to open and to say, God, I thank you. God, I glorify you. God, I honor you. For transformation power. I'm almost done. Hallelujah. As you meditate on the word, you begin, hallelujah, some way, somehow, to memorize God's word. Stuff that you were reading and thinking about, it just comes out of you. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High God shall abide under the... Listen, the word, you should be so full of, cast all of your cares upon the Lord, for he can. You should be so full of the word of God. Now we know that all things work together for the good of them who love the Lord, who are called according to his purpose. There should be so much word in you because you're connected, because you're gaining the mind of Christ. You're being transformed. You're being metamorphosized into the likeness of God, that God will gradually make your mind more spiritual than would be carnal. God will make your mind more spiritual. So even when it comes to business, you won't look at business the same. God will give you a spiritual mind to handle business. Come on, he'll breathe on you to give you an entrepreneur spirit. Lord, have mercy. He'll breathe on you to be able to lead in areas that you've never been qualified to lead in if you only listen to the master. You give him your will, you give him your mind, and your mind controls your body, and you, and your will controls your mind. Yeah, y'all didn't hear me. I said your mind controls your body, and your will controls your mind. Many people think that they can control their will or their willpower, but usually they fail. This was Paul's experience as recorded early on in Romans. I'm referencing all of Romans. Romans 7, 15 through 21. It is only when we yield to the will of God that his power can take over and give us the willpower that we need to be victorious as followers of Christ. Finally, the believer must prove, dokimeso, must prove the will of God. And that word prove, here it is, means both to find and to follow. Did you hear what I said? To prove me, we've got to find the will and follow it. Come on, you got to seek after God. You got to have tenacity as you're stretching, as you're chasing after God, God's will. This is understandable. If a person's mind is not renewed and focused upon God, then you'll just give up seeking for God. Come on, you'll just do whatever is natural for you to do. How can a person ever find or discover or know the will of God? How can that person ever follow or obey the will of God if a person's mind is not renewed and focused upon God? The only conceivable way that a person can ever find and follow God's will is to focus and to keep his mind upon God and upon the things of God. Meditating upon the will of God. God's will is said to be good. It's said to be beneficial. God's will is said to be bountiful. It's said to be suitable. His will is said to be moral. God's will, hallelujah, is acceptable. I'm still in the book. It's said to be pleasing and satisfactory and welcoming. It's said God's will is perfect, without error or mistake. It's flawless, it's complete, it's absolute, it's free of any sort of nothingness, completely fulfilled. And we've got victory. Say, we've got victory in Jesus. We've got victory when our minds are focused on him, when we're focused on his way and not our own. Hallelujah. Philippians 4 and 8 says, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true. Hallelujah. Whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think. In the mind, the will, think on these things. As I close with you being a trailblazer, with your body in your mind, hallelujah. I heard an interesting story. I wanted to share it with you today. A story that I thought would bless you as the doors of the church are open. If you want to give your life to Christ, you can do it now. Bible says, confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God is raised from the dead and you will be saved. Be a trailblazer. Commit your mind. Commit your body to God. Let your will be turned over to His will. Hallelujah. Take on God's willpower. For the believer, I want to encourage you. I heard a story that simply said, do something. Maybe you heard this story before. There was a church by the name of St. Michael's. St. Michael's Church were few in number, but mighty in their ability to give. They only had 300 members, and collectively, each year their budget was $1 million. St. Michael's was that kind of who's who's church, small in number, but great in faith. But as people got older, the neighborhood started to change. It went from a very high class and a place to be to low income. The job market left the area of St. Michael's. Its members got older. People started to die out. They were still faithful in their giving. But instead of open windows, bars were put up over windows in the neighborhood. The climate had changed. There was a new pastor, a young pastor that they called on staff at St. Michael's, and they would gather together, and the story goes on that even as they gathered together after church, they would have coffee and pastries. And they would talk about their week. They would fellowship with each other. But this particular Sunday in the fellowship hall, it had a guy that was dressed poorly. In fact, he looked a little homeless. He tried to move as fast as he could, and he reached out and grabbed the pastry and began to chew on it. Looking around scarcely, he grabbed another pastry, stuffed it in his pocket. While he was still eating the pastry that he got it the first time, he grabbed and reached for another pastry, and one of the senior members of the church was seeing what was taking place, and they were talking with this young minister that had come on staff, and one of the mothers of the church said, well, aren't you going to do something? He said, yes, wait a minute, hold my coffee. He goes over discreetly as the man is looking around and now starting to feel awkward. He still reaches for another pastry, put it in his pocket. Young pastor reaches down an empty pastry box and takes what's left of the pastries and pours them all into the box, puts them in the man's hands, and the man lifts his head up and walks out proudly with all of the pastries because they had been given to him. Then he goes back and grabs his coffee and says, this is what you wanted me to do something, right? I'll leave you to think about that for a moment, but too often, family, we don't do enough. Too often we're quick to be the gatekeepers. We're quick to tell somebody how they can and cannot serve. We're quick to shut stuff down and not be liberators. Here to let you know that young preacher was trailblazing. That man didn't have a penny in his pocket, but he came to the church because the church was able to meet the physical need. What's the point of the story? This young preacher had a renewed mind. He had a renewed will. And he was transformed from the inside out. He was willing to go against the cultural norms in order to meet the needs. Because I believe, he believed like me, God shall supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory. Won't you be like that young preacher? Won't you too be a trailblazer? Won't you too trust God with your body? Come on, Jesus said it best. My Father is able to look up the birds of the air, the beasts of the field. How much more will he do for you who love him? May we bow. Father, thank you for the fruit of your word on today. Thank you, oh God, that you look beyond our faults and you met us at our point of need. We want to encourage each other with this word to remind each other that you're calling us to commitment. You're calling us to be transformed, and you're calling us to give all that we have so that you might be glorified. Lord, we love you and we praise you. Thank you for this word. Thank you for the trailblazers that have gone before us. Help us to please you and all that we do, all that we say. We want to bring you glory. We want to bring you honor. We want to bring you praise, oh God. We say, have your way, oh Lord. In the mighty and the awesome name of Jesus the Christ, the soon coming King. We say together, amen, amen, amen. We want to encourage you today. We want to encourage you to be a trailblazer. Hallelujah. We bless God. We bless God that we will be having a church business meeting on March the 24th. We want to encourage you to be there. Information about that will take place so that as members, as trailblazers in God's kingdom, we can see together what God has in store for us. Now may the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with us, hence now and forevermore. Thank you for calling us to be trailblazers. In Jesus' name we pray. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody give the Lord a thunderous praise. Hallelujah. 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 God bless you as you go on your way. Amen.
I know you can make it. I know you can. No matter what may come my way, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hey, with him, I know I can take it.
Oh, glory, glory.
I feel him all in my spirit right now. I feel him. Thank you, Jesus. No matter what may come my way. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. No matter what you're going through, his grace and mercy do it for him. He loves you. I know he does.